Hey, what's going on, everyone? Welcome to my Afl Supercoach 2019 team reveal video. We're finally at that part of the season where we get to finally kick it all off. We're 2 days away from round one. It's been a long preseason for a lot of supercoaches, pulling their hair out, trying to find the right team, the right structure, who to go with. It's been a bit different this year. The thing I've noticed the most is we've come across a lot of expensive rookies. That's something I didn't like. I don't like having to spend money on rookies because they're rookies. And you don't know what they're going to be capable of. It's just been one of those weird off seasons, weird pre seasons to think. There's a lot of options, a lot of different options, a lot of mid prices are coming into it this year. And yeah, so without further ado, we'll go ahead and I'll draft my team that will be playing for me going into round one. I've got a bit of a different structure. I found myself being talked into a lot of players, and then I'd pick them, and then a day or two later, I'd be like, oh, hang on, I don't know about that. I'd be convinced this person, you have to have this person or that person. So I had to get outside of my own head and stop overthinking things and just get a team on the park that I like, a team that I think is capable of doing good numbers and picking players that I think can make me money. And yeah, so without further ado, we will go ahead. So my first defensive player, he's been in there since day one, Zach Williams. He's a great player. Missed all the last year. He played one quarter of JLT, and that alone shows what he's capable of. Coming in for the next position is Brody Smith. Very capable ball user, can get a lot of the ball, and he can has potential to score really well. Coming in third, I think we'll notice now that I'm not investing a lot of money into my back line. I didn't like any of the premiums for their price. That could very much come back and bite me on the ass. You got guys like Lloyd, Laird, Cicely, Simpson, Whitfield, even Shannon Hearn. I had Shannon Hearn in my side up until about 2 days ago. I'm hoping that some prices might drop a bit have some potential upgrade targets. Fourth in the back line will be Jordan Clark. He will definitely start round one for Geelong because Jed Buse and Zach Tui are out. He really has the potential to play well and secure his spot. Unfortunately, possibly pushing Jed Buse out if that's the situation that comes to. I hope not. I love Jed Buse and I like him in our back line, so we'll see what happens. The next rookie I've got in is Xavier Dersma. I just read a thing on Dr. Supercoach, and Ken Hinckley has come out and confirmed that Dersma, Butters, Drew, and Rosie will all debut this week. So, get them in, get them on the ground, and get some early rookie points and cash. And then last on the ground is Marty Hoare. I'm not too sure whether he'll get in this week or not. I'm hoping so. He's on the ground for now. And then I've got McKay and Joyce on the pine. Now we're coming to the midfield, which is where I have spent the bulk of my money. My main reason for that is the new 666 rule is going to suit midfielders. And the fact that midfielders are reliable, and that's why I've got them in. First, it hurt me to spend this much money, but I'd be more upset if I didn't pick him and he scored big scores. Me thinking, oh, he's going to drop in price, and he only drops like 60K. Just get him in, I think. So Jackson McRae for me, for sure. I think this new rule will suit him. Next, contested ball king, Cripps. I would absolutely be shocked if people didn't think he'd be a good pick. Get him in. If Carlton win 10 games, I think he wins the Brownlow, to be perfectly honest. Coming in number third, I'm going to look like a big hypocrite here, because in my last video, I completely shunned him, wiped him off, didn't want to bar him, but I've had more time to think about it, and look, his first four games are pretty easy. He comes up against North Melbourne against his first game. His history shows he scores well against them. I'm going with Fife. Last year, I had him in the start of my season. I think he hurt himself for like a week, and I just rage traded him straight away and didn't get him back in. I might have got him back in late. I can't remember. So I'm going to start Fife and play him and only trade him if he gets a serious injury. A serious injury. And I just fingers crossed he has an unhindered season from injuries, because his ceiling's huge. Next, Fife's old teammate, Lockie Neal. He's a guy that really has has potential to score great every week. And for that price, I think you pay it. I think you definitely pay it. I think Brisbane are going to be really good, like decent this year. And he's just going to add to that. So he's in for sure. Next is Cornelio. I had him all of last year. He scored really well. A lot of people probably picked Josh Kelly over him. I'm not sure. Josh Kelly didn't play JLT. GWS are notorious for not giving out information. I had heard rumours that he was injured. Can't confirm or deny that at all, but I'm not risking it. I'm going Cornelio. He had a great JLT series. GWS have been predicted by a lot of people to do really well, and I think Cornelio is going to score great all year. Coming in after him, Dusty Martin. He was another guy that a lot of people aren't picking due to last year's sort of up and down season. My theory is his ceiling is too big to not pick him at that price. He's recently come out saying that he's battled anxiety and depression all the last year because of the standards he set himself in 2017. 2017 he won a Brownlow Premiership and a Norm Smith all in the 1 year. Had like one of the best individual seasons you'll ever see. That could definitely hinder on a player. I can definitely see that being something that you battle with, thinking, I've got to come out and perform to that every week. And you see comments. I mean, it's the internet. People are going to jump on it and say dumb shit. There's people saying that he's only saying he's got anxiety and depression to dodge any drug testing, because the rule is if you say you've got a mental health issue, you don't have to do the drug testing. And Nick Rewald has come out stating he knows players that are saying that they've got these issues when they don't, just to skip out on doing the drug testing. My theory is I don't believe that Dusty's doing that, because if you do say you've got a mental health issue to skip the drug testing, you don't have to come out and say, like, you don't have to publicise it. So if Dusty was doing that just to dodge drug testing, I don't see why he'd come out and say it. The fact that he has come out and said it makes me really believe he's got it, and he's trying to, you know, bring awareness to it and talk about it and help himself. And I now think that because he's come out and said it, he's going to have a lot of relief off himself and relieve some pressure, and he can get back to his best. So he's in for me. He's a lock, and I've got high expectations for him. Next for me is my first mid sort of high expectation player. I'm bringing Tom Liberatore in at $300,000. He's had a great preseason. He scored well in the JLT. He looks fit. I've talked about him in a few videos. He looks really rare and ready to go. So I've got him in for sure. And then the first rookie on the ground is Walsh. He scored great in the JLT. If he can average like 90, I mean, I can't see me trading him, to be honest. If he can get 90 plus each week. So that's me midfield. Very expensive, very highly stacked, but I'm pretty confident in their scores and their ability. On the bench, Butters, Constable and Atkins. Coming into me rucks, tossed and turned at night, losing very, very much a lot of sleep. Didn't know whether to go Grundy, Gorn, Grundy, Goldstein, Gorn, Goldstein, or anything like that, but in the end, I went Grundy, Gorn, because I think you just pick them and leave them. Supercoach George said that they are the two best by a mile in the competition, and you're only eventually going to have to upgrade to them later if you pick Goldstein or someone. So why bother? Just get him in from the start and try and keep a bit more hair on your head come season end than you would if you didn't pick him. Coming into the forward line, Absolute no-brainer. Danger. Patrick Dangerfield. Very, very, very good preseason. One of his most uninterrupted ones for a long time. He's very fit. He's very strong. He's very fast. He's very undefendable in the way that it's hard to stop him. In this new 666 rule, he's going to dominate. He's seen the JLT, how he really had a good time at that. So, Danger for me, absolute no-brainer. Probably top three in the Brownlow again. Coming in second is Heaney. This guy's a star. He's young. He doesn't get talked about a lot because he plays for Sydney. I feel like interstate teams don't get a big rap. I think if he was in a Victorian club, he would be compared to someone like the Bont and other guys where he's just got a huge ceiling and can score very well. So he's in for me. He's going to help Sydney, I believe, definitely get back to the top eight. I think they're the top eight side for sure, despite what a lot of other people are saying. But in third, Jack Billings. He was a trap last year. I'm giving him a second chance, although I don't think I had him last year, but a lot of people did not like him at all. But he's in for me. It was either him or Michael Walters, which it was Michael Walters until like 2 days ago, and then I saw the Jesse Hogan thing, yesterday or today. And I think Freo's got a lot of issues. So I'm just going with Billings for now. It could come back bite me on the ass because, as I said, Freo's got a good first four rounds. But it's me, it's Billings. So hopefully he scores well. And then the rookies, got Setterfield. I don't like the price, but I think he'll play a lot of games and he's got potential to score really well. So then the other rookie, Burgess, don't really know how he's going to go, but we'll get him in. And then Willem Drew from, like I said, he's debuting this week. So get him in and get him on. And then the bench guys, Petroselli and Parker. And that's my side. That is what I'm going into for the first round. I'll have two videos a week, obviously an update from the round and then a video of trade upgrade targets and stuff like that. Last year I was pretty retarded and dumb with my trades and it bit me on the ass at the end of the year because I had two trades left and I wanted to upgrade. Coming into the finals, Nat Nui got injured and Sicily got injured. And I had to use my two trades to get those guys out. So it bit me in the ass. So I'm going to be a bit passive with my trades early on. Try and get some rookies to build up some cash. And by that stage, I can find out who I like premium defensively wise. And I can bring those guys in. If Jack Billings is averaging dumb scores, I could probably potentially do a rage trade there. But as far as my midfield, I mean, McRae, Cripps, Fife, Neil, Canelo, and Dusty aren't very likely to be traded at all unless injured. I've got high expectations for Libba to score consistently every week, so I can't see me trading him, again, unless he's injured, or unless he pulls a Billings from last year and scores shit. And then it's just rookies to upgrade. But that's it. That's the side I'm going into. Good luck to everyone else who's pulling on the coach's hat this year. And, yeah, we'll see you in the next video. Thanks, guys.